Hi, this is Dr. Harry Anderson. Welcome. I'm here with Mr. Tyler Morris. Tyler, good to see you again.
You too, sir.
Tyler, I've been working with you for a couple of years now, and kind of understand your background. You're kind of a little kid that grew up in Alpine, Texas, correct?
Yes, sir.
On a ranch?
Yes, sir.
So you've been around horses and ranching and that environment where horses had to work.
Right.
They had to perform
yes.
all the time, and you couldn't have outlaws. You couldn't have bad guys out there because right. they're dangerous.
Yes.
So you've kind of learned through the years without any formal education, but a self-taught person that can understand horses, and that's what I've learned to appreciate, is your ability to look at and interact with a horse and know a lot about it, especially kind of what it needs
right.
and when things change and how they're changing. Tell me a little bit about your background as to where you came from and how you came to do some of this stuff. You were telling me a story about your uncle.
Yes. When I was very young, we always kept horses. We had four brood mares and a stallion, and we always had young horses coming up. So one day, my uncle said, "Hey, I want you to learn something today." He said, "I want you to go out and interface with eight horses that we had, young horses, yearlings to two-year-olds. He said, "I want you to interface with these horses and don't take a halter, don't take anything, just go out there. But the thing that I want you to do is I want you to think about one of those horses. Just think about it." So I went out there and spent several hours observing them and interacting with the horses, and finally came back, and my uncle asked me, "What did you learn?" I said, "Well, the only horse that wouldn't let me touch him or come close to him was the one I was thinking about." So the lesson that I learned there is that horses are so perceptive about who the predators are that even if you're just thinking about them, they know it.
Okay. That's a very interesting thing. And you've kind of taken that little lesson that took you just a few hours
right.
and turned it into a lifelong understanding and the ability to help other people understand their horses.
Yes.
And how they are reacting to what's going on in their environment.
Correct. What I found is that many times what has become commonplace for me to observe has been difficult for other people to observe about their own actions or their interactions with their horse, because those horses always have a reaction. And sometimes they're very, very subtle. It may only be a slight flick of an ear, but it's timing. It's exactly when that horse flicks the ear. Or most recently, I was working with a trainer whose horse was not only, you know, he was flicking his tail a little bit and his ear, and he was also eyeballing her. And that's another one of those telltale signs when the horse is really, when he has so much, you know, anxiety about what's going on, he actually turns his head just slightly enough to, you know, to give to eyeball the rider, and then you know that there's something else that you need to address.
Something is bothering that horse about that person, is what you're saying, or the environment.
It could be. Could be
okay.
both.
Okay.
Typically, what I found is that it boils down to what we can do to change that horse's feed.
Okay. Okay. Well, Tyler, you've been working with Total Equine in a lot of different environments, different disciplines,
right.
different breeds of horses, different and all kinds of things, different owners, of course.
Yes.
And you've related some things to me that you have found with Total Equine as a general thing throughout all of these different situations. What have you seen mainly?
One of the things that I found that's probably been the most common is that many of the riders, and their horses will demonstrate this as well, is that they don't want to go left, or they're bracy coming back to the right. Well, they're with different disciplines, what I'm learning, I mean, I've never been a hunter jumper or never done dressage, but I'm learning, people are very helpful to teach me a lot about that. But what I have seen is that some of those horses have an irritation on the right side, which predominantly what I've determined is, you know, gas in the cecum, where they become irritable. And they demonstrate that irritability by not performing to the left as well as they do to the right. And we've seen a lot of horses with those performance issues. And, you know, as we begin to switch those horses over to total equine, we're able to see a great change in those horses. And I had one of the trainers came back to me and told me 30 days later, she said, "Well, my horse does everything to the left as well as he does to the right." And she was very happy about that.
Well, that's a very interesting observation on your part, because one of the things that with total equine, when total equine, the nutrients from total equine get into the cecum and the colon, it apparently, and this is something we cannot prove, but apparently enhances or increases the fermentation mm-hmm. of the fiber so that horses eat less fiber. Mm-hmm. They're getting more out of it. So they don't eat near as much. Therefore, they have less of this fermentation overall yeah. to have that gas that you're talking about, right. less discomfort. So the horse is moving differently simply because they're more comfortable. Would that be fair?
Absolutely. And I think, you know, they also, I think those horses become more willing to interface with their rider because they feel better. You know, they start feeling better, and now, you know, the rider and the horse are able to, they have a better communication process. Mm-hmm. It may be the same yeah. process as before, you know, right leg, left, horse moves left, rein in combination with the right rein, but the horses seem to become more patient and more willing to tolerate their rider.
A little less anxiety?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. And that has to do with, and this goes back to some of the things we use in total equine. One of the things that I think what you're alluding to here is the presence of the Ascophyllum nodosum, yes. which is a specific species of seaweed that we use in total equine that contains that fucose sugar so important for nerve transmission in the body. Yeah. And so the nerves are just functioning better. Right. But the other thing is, goes back to that fermentation in the hind gut. If we eliminate the raw starch going into the hind gut so that raw starch is not fermenting yeah. anymore, we reduce the lactic acid production, which is a normal part of that fermentation. We reduce that to a low level. Lactic acid is one of the things that makes horses nervous, mm-hmm. and it causes a histamine production in the body, which causes a vasoconstriction, which causes laminitis. So some of the things you're talking about are a lot of little things improving and not causing discomfort in that horse.
Right.
But a lot of what you talk about is comfort, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, absolutely.
If a horse does not have discomfort, they act normal.
You got a willing
You make
partner.
Them uncomfortable,
yeah.
they start acting up.
Absolutely.
Okay.
If the pad doesn't fit right, or you know, or they're cinchy, or whatever it happens mm-hmm. to be, I mean, if you can keep them more comfortable, you've removed all the barriers that are right. keeping them from performing the way you want them to.
Right. And I'm talking about, you know, the lack of laminitis and better hoof. A lot of customers tell me that the hoof growth is increased, the rate of growth is increased, and hoof quality is better. Have you seen that in any of the horses you've worked with?
Absolutely. And I've also gotten that report from several of the really good farriers in our territory. They've also made that very same comment. One of the things that I've noticed in my trial horses, that's my horses, they're my guinea pigs, but what I've noticed in them was after about a year, I noticed that there was a hydration in the hoof that I had never seen before. So, and I had, you know, an old horse that had very bad feet, and after about a year on total equine, the horse's foot was so good that, you know, she began to wear it normally. And, you know, hadn't been to the farrier in a long time just because she was able to, you know, to wear that foot normally.
Okay.
And it was pretty impressive.
Yeah, that's great. That's great to hear, because this is very similar to a lot of stories I get from people. Mm-hmm. And how about older horses? I get stories about older horses that are feeling better, moving easier, and yeah. just overall better condition with better muscling, increased muscling? Do you see any of that in older horses?
No question, absolutely. I have in our territory that I'm aware of for horses that I've evaluated, we have two Arabs that were, one was 34 and one was 32. And I just saw the 32-year-old horse not too long ago. And we've been having, you know, very, very bad freezing weather. And he looked great. He was alert. He definitely didn't look like a 10-year-old horse. I mean, he was 32 years old and retired from a very heavy show schedule in his younger days. And he was alert. He was bouncing around, and he was just feeling really good, you know. So I don't know what 32 equates to in human years, but it got to be over 100.
Probably about 70 like me. We're still going strong.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, that's great. I really appreciate these comments and stories, Tyler, and thanks for your time. And
Thank you. You've
done well up here in Indiana and Wisconsin and Illinois for a little kid from Alpine, Texas,
and we just
appreciate what you're doing.
Thank you.
For more information about this or any other horse topic, visit theadvicebarn.com or totalfeeds.com.